Good afternoon, everyone. This is 287. Today I'm going to continue with this short mini-series entitled, What About This Scripture? And the scripture I'm going to talk about today is one that's used over and over to instill in the mind of many that when you die, you go straight to heaven. And it's simply, in part, on my belief that people believe this because they don't study diligently to see that it doesn't mean what they think it means. It's saying what it's saying, and that's a given fact, but they're misinterpreting actually what it's saying. So we're going to talk about that for a few minutes, and we're going to show you that scripture does not contradict itself. What I taught earlier, or what I reiterated earlier, what scripture says about when we die, we go to the grave, and we're there into the resurrection, holds true, and scripture does not contradict itself. So we're going to talk about this, and I'm going to show you what the word says about that. And if you disagree, that's fine. We are all entitled to have our own opinion. If you disagree, you disagree. But I'm going to stick by what the word says, and it's not up for debate by me because it is what it is. So with that being said, let's move on to the thief on the cross. Now, we're going to look at Luke 23:43, because this is a scripture that is at the crux of a lot of this. Luke 23:43, and it reads, "And Jesus said unto him, Verily I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise." Now, if you just read it on the surface without putting any thought into it, and this is what I'm saying, without putting any thought into it, if you're not digging into it, studying it to get a thorough understanding of what scripture is saying, on the surface it can sound like, I'm saying to you today, yeah, you'll be in paradise. But stop and break it down. This is what we have to do with scripture. If it were that simple to understand, anyone could pick up scripture and read it and get it. But the Father tells us that all discernment of knowledge and his word comes from him. So anybody can't just pick up scripture and get that discernment. You have to study and be into his word for him to bring that understanding to you. Because any scripture on the surface is supported by many other scriptures to get a thorough understanding of what it's saying. Now, first, let's ignore the comma, because that can get in the way of the understanding with a lot of folks, the punctuation here. Understand, the comma was not invented until the 3rd century. Historically, when scribes wrote whatever was dictated to them, they wrote it word for word without punctuation. So whatever they were told, they wrote. They wrote, they wrote, they wrote. No punctuations, no commas, no periods, no question marks, none of that. They just wrote it all out. And then here we come into the 3rd century with punctuation and all these things, and that's been implanted into scripture since it was written. So there can be some grammatical errors in just punctuation alone, but the word is still the word. Don't let that kind of stuff trip you up. It's still saying what it's saying without the punctuation. So to not go off on that tangent, we're going to move forward. If you want to dig into that, you're free to do it. History, the teaching is all there about all this punctuation and how it came about. But to be simple, our Savior was simply making a promise to that thief on the cross. Remember, there were two thieves. Now, one remained who he was, apparently, and the other one, he got it. And he asked the Savior to remember him when he went to heaven. And the Savior turned around to him and simply said, today, however you want to phrase it, but he simply was telling him, today, I make you this promise. You will be with me in paradise. Now, you can read it to make it seem as though he's saying, today, you're going to be in paradise with me, or however you want to spin it. But that's not what he was saying. He said, today I make you this promise, you will be with me in paradise. Now, to understand it in a simple context that way, and make scripture hold true from what I taught before about death. When that thief was to fall upon death, he was going to be buried. He was going to be into the grave until the resurrection. But the Savior had made him a promise that he had a place in paradise. Because why? The thief became a believer and he was baptized. Now, we could talk about baptism, but I'm not going to go off on that tangent. He wasn't baptized by water. He wasn't baptized by sprinkling or any of that immersion. He was baptized in the Word, by the Word. That's how we're all baptized. We can do these symbolic things, but we are only truly baptized in the Word. So moving on from there, let me give you some more confirmation or understanding as to why the thief didn't go straight to heaven that day. First of all, the Savior himself did not go straight to heaven that day after he died on the cross. He went to the grave. Now, some would have you believe that he didn't stay there, but he confirmed that when he came out of the grave 3 days later. Remember, he was crucified on Friday, one day. It doesn't matter how much time was left in Friday. It constitutes a day in prophetic time. He died Friday, one day. Saturday, the seventh day, was the second day. He was dead on the third day, which was Sunday, but he rose on the third day. So 3 days later, he rose as he had promised. And when he came out of the tomb, who did he run into? He ran into Mary. She went to touch him, and what did he say? Well, let's look at John 20:17. Everyone seems to know this one pretty well also. But we're going to read it out of scripture as it is written. John 20:17, it reads, Jesus said unto her, touch me not, for I am not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren and say unto them, I ascend unto my Father and your Father, and to my God and to your God. So that confirmed that he hadn't even went to his Father yet. But we know what happened to him on that Friday. He was crucified and put in the grave. And when he came out of the tomb, he told Mary, I haven't even been to my Father yet. So that confirms that he was still in the tomb. If he wasn't in the tomb, he had to be walking around somewhere, because he confirms that he had not went to his Father. So in the tomb, there he was. So he didn't go straight to heaven upon his death. So what makes us think that the thief would go straight to heaven? It makes no sense. Why wouldn't the Savior go straight to heaven, but yet the thief go straight to heaven? That's out of order. The thief has no importance, neither do we, over the Savior himself. So we're not going to be privileged to something that glorious that he isn't privy to. He left after 3 days. He did go to the Father. For what? Acknowledgement. From what? For what? Fulfilling the promise. He went to the Father after he told Mary that, and he came back the same day. Now, follow me in scripture. John 16:28. So we're going to go to John 16:28. John 16:28, he says, I come forth from the Father and am come into the world. Again, I leave the world and go to the Father. So when he left Mary, he went to the Father that same day. Now, why did he go to the Father? Well, let's look at John 13:3. John 13:3 reads, it says, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he was come from God and went to God. So upon his resurrection and telling Mary, don't touch me yet, I haven't went to the Father, he sent her on a mission, and then he went on a mission. He went to the Father for the acknowledgement, for fulfilling the promise, because he understood and knows that all things come from the Father. So to the Father was his first stop once he resurrected. He went to the Father. He didn't stop by the grave to get the thief or anyone else. He went straight to the Father because he still had work to do. So he went to the Father and he came back the same day. Now, if we look at Ephesians 1:17 right quick, it'll tell us why he went to the Father first. Ephesians 1:17 says, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. That's why he went to the Father. And the reference to that gives a little more clarity. It says, and for acknowledgement. He went to the Father for the acknowledgement and what he had to get from the Father to bring back for what? To give to the disciples, to share to all of us, to all of mankind. So he left the grave, told Mary not to touch him because he hasn't gone to the Father, sent her on her mission. He went to the Father on his mission to get that acknowledgement and all the knowledge and wisdom for all the things that we need, and came back. And where did he go? He went to the disciples. Now let's look at Matthew 28, and we're going to start with verse 18. It says, and Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even through the end of the world. So when he came back, he spent that time with the disciples, teaching them for us what they needed to share with us. Now go with me to Mark 16, verses 19 and 20, and they read, so then, after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven and sat on the right hand of God. And they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word with signs following. Amen. So after he told them what to do, that's what happened. Scripture's clear. It tells us what happened. And then finally, if we look at Luke 24:50 and 51, it reads this. It says, and he led them out as far as Bethany, and he lifted up his hands and blessed them. And it came to pass, while he blessed them, he was parted from them and carried up into heaven. So there's a sequence of what happened. He taught them, and then he took them out to a certain place, and he departed from them. So go with me to Acts 1, verses 2 and 3, so we can find a few more details about what happened and how long he was here. Acts 1, verses 2 and 3, it says, until the day in which he was taken up. After that, he, through the Holy Ghost, had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. So it's all there. It tells us what happened after his crucifixion. He was in a grave 3 days. He came out. Mary went to touch him. He said, no, don't touch me. I haven't went to the Father yet. He sent her on her mission. He went on his mission to get the acknowledgement for fulfilling the promise and the things that were going to be given him to share with mankind. And he was here for 40 days teaching his disciples what they needed to know. And then he gave them that mandate of what to do with all that information and knowledge. And then he took them out of Jerusalem into outside of Bethany, and he departed them and went up to heaven. So the thief, the thief did not go straight to heaven. At no point does the scripture say he took the thief to heaven, definitely not that same day, and no time in between. It's clear to me, without trying to make it seem like something it isn't, it makes no mention about the thief. After that day, the Savior made him a promise that he had a place in the kingdom. That's what he was telling him. And as we all have a place in the kingdom, if we do according to his will. And there's nothing that says that any of us are going to go straight to heaven when we die. Everything is contrary to that idea or ideology. Everything says that we're going to the grave. And then if we're righteous when the time comes, we're going to be raised with those other saints in the clouds. So I'm going to cut it off there, And with that being said, agree or disagree, study the word for yourself. I study it for me, and I share with those who want to listen. I'm not here to get into debates or disagreements. It's the word. It speaks for itself. So, that being said, remember, the Heavenly Father does not call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be faithful. This is 2 of 8 7. I'm out. Thank you.